Welcome to Bible 360, 2 Thessalonians. Much like in his first letter to the Thessalonian church, Paul encourages the church to persevere in the face of opposition from neighbors and from their own city government. Paul says they're being an example to other Christians because of their perseverance. Even though their suffering may make it feel like they're losing right now, God will eventually give them the ultimate victory. Those who abuse them and mistreat them currently are going to eventually be overthrown and removed. Paul says they're flaunting their glory and power now, causing you to suffer, but you stay the course, because eventually they're going to suffer the consequences for their nasty attitudes and actions, and you will meanwhile be glorified with Christ in accordance with God's good plan. Paul spends a lot of time discussing the return of Christ and some of the events leading up to it. Paul had touched on this letter in his first letter to Thessalonians. Now he wants to clear up some misunderstandings and misapplications of what he said. First of all, he tells them not to freak out despite those who claim the day of the Lord has already come and they've somehow missed it. That's ridiculous, Paul says, because Jesus is going to return, and when he does, he'll put all his enemies under his feet. His rule will be complete. The Thessalonians know that evil men are still existing and surviving, even in their very own city. Clearly, Paul says, the end has not come yet. Paul describes the rise and ultimately the defeat of a man of lawlessness. Now, it's hard to pinpoint exactly who this character is. The only definition that makes a lot of sense to me is that Paul is talking about generally empires or powerful individuals, and perhaps he's thinking of the Roman Empire as one such prime example. After all, during the Pax Romana, Rome claimed to rule the whole world. The worship of Caesar began to catch on in different parts of the empire, and emperors themselves became more infatuated with their own glory and power and began demanding complete allegiance in some cases. They claimed that they could bring peace, stability, and the ultimate good for humankind and the world. Rome, with all its military and engineering glory, along with its pursuit of wealth and pleasure, claimed to be worthy of the highest honor and of individual sacrifices. The good of the empire was the justification of all kinds of atrocities and evils. If this is a reference to the Roman pagan worldview, it need not be limited to a warning against Rome, which is, of course, long dead and buried. This is probably why Paul is intentionally ambiguous about the exact nature or name of this man of lawlessness. No matter what it is referencing, it clearly is encouraging Christians not to be alarmed by the corrupt powers of either individuals or empires, or of powerful individuals who rule empires. Jesus is the real Lord to whom we owe allegiance, and the one who actually controls history and the destiny of the world. But before evil is completely defeated and overthrown, it first will show its true colors and gain immense power and popularity. Don't be deceived into thinking that this is simply politics or worldly power at play. Satanic and evil forces lurk in the background, and sometimes they come more obviously to the forefront of the picture. And their designs are to rule people's hearts and minds and attempt to delude even God's own people. Now, even if some of the details of the son of lawlessness or man of lawlessness are a bit fuzzy on purpose, Paul makes his application or response to such illusions and temptations crystal clear. We ought to always give thanks because we, for our part, have been included in God's eternal plan through Jesus. This happened not through any political power, but through the working of the Holy Spirit. It's the gospel of Jesus which has saved you, not Rome. It's in Christ that you have been included. So don't be distracted by other deceptive powers. Hold firm. Don't waver on what I've been teaching you guys. After all, other powers and people make lots of promises and often fail to deliver. But Jesus has actually shown us a resurrected life in his own body. He has preached forgiveness and demonstrated reconciliation in his own life and now in the life of believers. And that's why we hold on to him. Paul asks for them to pray for him because Paul does face nasty men with evil plans. Remember, this is neither a surprise or up for debate among the Thessalonians. They had personally and perhaps traumatically saw Paul dragged out of their own community by a mob for preaching forgiveness and resurrection hope. Yet Paul does not ask for vengeance or legal action to help him, but rather for their prayers. Paul then directs them not to otherwise misuse his teaching about Jesus' return and the restoration of all things. Because some were taking this teaching and saying, well, if Jesus is coming back soon, like Paul says, then why waste my time working or doing anything productive? I'll just quit my day job and rely on others. Paul points out that he never encouraged this sort of response. In fact, he preached the exact opposite. And he practically worked twice as hard as anyone else, even though he was the one preaching Christ's return. Time is short. That's what they should take away from the return of Christ. So make the most of the time that you have, and not by being lazy, but by working hard so that you have extra to share with others. Paul's rebuke is quite strong. If anybody is a lazy busybody, he says, don't share food with them. Everyone's got to pull their own weight. Paul's last encouragement is not to grow weary of doing good, but to keep up the good work. Paul signs this letter, one of the few that he actually wrote on his own instead of employing a scribe, saying, "The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all." The application of this letter is simple but powerful. Paul wants us to stand firm in the faith of the New Testament. The gospel of Jesus doesn't need a lot of embellishment or military power. The words of Jesus simply need to be listened to and acted on in faith. No other power, including the powers of individuals or even nations, should distract or change the character of the gospel. God's kingdom is better because of the content and the character of the message that Jesus proclaimed. It's also more trustworthy because Jesus has followed through on his promises. He's not using us, but rather he has died for our salvation.